Thank you for joining us for the 2022 Smithsonian National Education Summit. Please welcome back to the stage Smithsonian Undersecretary for Education, Dr. Monique Chism.
Hello, hello, hello. Hi, Adriana. Adriana was one of our speakers yesterday. It's so good to see you. Welcome back, everyone. Did you have a good day?
Yes.
Okay. Good sessions, right? Welcome to our virtual audience. I hope that you also had an enjoyable experience at your breakout sessions. I'm Dr. Monique Chism. I'm the Undersecretary for Education here at the Smithsonian. I'd like to start off by telling you just a little verbal description of who I am for those who might need it. I'm an African-American woman. I'm very tall. I have on a royal blue dress. My hair is short and curly in a natural style. And I'm coming to you from the auditorium of the Smithsonian American Art Museum and the Smithsonian Portrait Gallery. So welcome to everyone. I also would like to begin with a land offering. We have presenters that have come to us for the last 2 days coming from many different places and want to say thank you. And so I'd like to say that we gratefully acknowledge the Native peoples on whose ancestral homelands we gather, as well as the diverse and vibrant Native communities who make their home here today. So thank you. So this is the close of our summit. I can't believe it. The last 2 days have been very powerful and moving. And I just want to remind us that we started off with the objective of honoring first and foremost and celebrating teacher voice. And then also making sure that we were raising up some challenging and difficult conversations around the state exclusions that are going on across the nation related to race, gender, and what can be taught. But then also equipping you and leaving you with some really pragmatic strategies to bring back to the classroom and back to your learning environments. So you can let us know if we accomplished that, but that was our goal. I've been just very moved by all the sessions and know that there are things that I'm going to take from each conversation. I'm really excited, though, about the closing keynote speaker. As you guys already know, it's Jason Reynolds, who is the New York Times bestselling author. He's a young adult author, but I think that you could really say that he resonates with many generations of readers. He has won numerous awards. We would be here probably for 20 minutes for me to list all of them, but I just want to say that it's an important recognition of his talent and his work, and I'm glad that the world is recognizing that. He is also the current National Ambassador for Young People's Literature for the Library of Congress, and he's on faculty at Lesley University. So please join me in welcoming to the stage Jason Reynolds. So welcome, Jason.
Thank you. Hi, everybody.
We have a virtual audience that is joining us also, so.
Hey, y'all, in cyberspace.
So we're gonna go ahead and jump into it. And you know, I'd love to start off with your role as National Youth Ambassador. Mm. And I know that you have set as one of your priorities to reach rural communities across the nation. So could you talk to us a little bit about why you decided to focus on rural communities and what you're learning and hearing?
Why rural communities? I mean, the honest answer is because, first and foremost, because there are children there, too. I think growing up here and then living in Brooklyn for my adult life, and then career starts and then you start traveling around and you realize, like, publishers are going to sort of try to figure out how to situate you in the biggest market, right? Because you got to make money, right? So it's like, we want to put you where the biggest market is. So you'll be in New York, you'll be in Atlanta, and you'll be in LA, and San Francisco, Chicago, Austin, Houston, Miami, DC, Philadelphia. That's it. That's how that goes, right? Like, these are your markets. And I think having done that for so many years, I started to branch out. Schools in smaller towns would reach out and say, can you come and talk to our kids? We're in Tuscaloosa, we're in Oxford, Mississippi, or even smaller, we're in Olney, Illinois, we're in Seward, Nebraska, right? And I'm like, you know, at first it's like, am I going to be safe?
Yeah.
Right? Like, those are sort of the initial thoughts. And then the second thought is like, well, I can't claim to work for young people. I can't claim to love young people. I can't claim to be in service to young people if that only includes some of them.
Right.
And not all of them. And so I made a hard decision to say, well, look, if there's kids there, then I can be there. I have no problem going away. Wherever there are children, those children belong to me. Those are my kids. My kids are all the kids, right? And I can't pick and choose and say, like, well, my kids are only the kids from D.C. or only the kids from Harlem and Brooklyn. It's like, nah, all the kids are my babies. And I have no problem with these children despite what the complications that one might have, and I use might, you know, one might have with their parents. That ain't got nothing to do with these babies, right? I can't judge them based on what I think about their parents, even though what I think about their parents in and of itself is also an assumption and a stereotype too. I'd rather go and then open myself up to be proven wrong. What have I experienced on the road? I experienced just that. Children are children everywhere. The beauty of them is that no matter where you go, they laugh at the same jokes. And that should be enough to give us hope. That should be enough to help us understand that as a world, right, and that's everywhere in the world, not just in America, right? I've been all over the globe, and kids all over the globe laugh at the same jokes, which means that inherently, intrinsically, we are connected and we are more the same than we are different, but you got to be open to the possibility of that. And in order to do that, one must complicate their own arguments,
right?
And so here I am as a young ambassador out there in the world doing that.
That's nice. I really like that. So I think your initiative was called Grab the Mic, Tell Your Story.
Yeah.
So what are you hearing? What are they saying? What do they want us to know?
That they love their hometowns, first and foremost. You know, I had the idea for this entire platform because I got elected. I mean, I got inaugurated in January of 2020. And so all of this is happening. We're coming off of, like, I mean, America's in all sorts of political turmoil. We've got all kind of stuff going on, right? And I was thinking to myself, man, I wonder what it would be like to give the microphone to the babies and let them say who they are. There's this thing that happens where everybody is speaking for everybody, but not everybody should be.
Right.
It's like, who am I to talk to speak on behalf of the kids in the heartland? I'm not from the heartland. I don't know what that is. I don't know what life is like in the middle of Arkansas. I don't know that, right? And so instead of me pretending to know, and instead of me sort of like stepping on, allowing myself to step onto a pedestal of arrogance, I'd rather just like put the microphone in their hands and ask them to tell me what they're proud of, what they love, what they need, what they want, where their pride lies, right? And what you hear is young people being like, yeah, man, I was in Montana, okay, maybe like maybe a month or two ago, and I'm in Montana, and it's the only time that I've ever been in a space where the young people who lived in that space understood the beauty of the space around them.
Tell me more about what that means.
So, like, growing up here, you know, a tourist comes to the city and says, yeah, like, yo, we went to the White House. I'm okay, like, bro, ain't nobody going to the White House tonight.
Right. Right.
You
right.
know, it's like, I have yeah. no desire to yeah. go there, right?
Right?
But if you come from out of town, you see the city in a very different way. If you right. go to New York, you talk to New Yorkers, they're like, bro, I got to go to work.
Yeah.
But if you talk to a tourist, they're like, this is the big city of dreams. And you talk to a New Yorker, they're like, this is the city of bills, right?
Yeah,
like,
right.
right? And so I think when I was in Montana, and I say to them, man, they say, what do you like about Montana? And I say, man, Montana is the most beautiful place I've ever been. Mm. And 900 young people are like, yeah, it is.
Okay.
Right? And yeah. I was like, because that's different, right? That's an interesting thing to yeah. hear, to see all these kids. And I say, oh, I think I'm going to learn how to fly fish. And then they're all like, you should, because we all do. We go after school, we walk down to the lake, right? And it's this interesting thing that I could have never known. I was in Nebraska, and kids are like, oh man, I love it here. We got our own salad dressing. You would love it. It's this, that, and the third.
And in that moment,
I have an opportunity to validate that experience, right? That's nothing to poo-poo. That's nothing to dismiss, right? Especially if this is the thing that allows this young person to have shoulders that are pulled back and a chest that is puffed up. Why not, right? Especially when so many people are telling you or telling or pretending to know what your town is about. Detroit is another one of these places that is a major city. But if you ask people who don't live in Detroit about Detroit, they'll be like, oh, Detroit, dying city. And then you say, well, have you been there? And they're like, oh, no, I've never been to Detroit.
Oh.
Right? If you ask a Michigander, right, they're like, Detroit, hometown, it's amazing. You know what I'm saying? 313 forever. Yeah, they're gonna. It's a whole thing,
pride,
right?
The whole pride.
I think that is what I've experienced over the years with the ambassadorship and in general with young people. They're waiting for someone to not tell them, but to ask them.
Mm.
And then they will tell you what there is to be proud of.
Okay.
And that's a gift to all of us, by the way.
I love that. So not to tell them, but to ask.
Like we want.
Like we want, right.
Yeah.
I don't like anybody to tell me what to do.
Just ask me.
Yeah, okay. My team knows that. Let me ask you, so I'm sure that in your travels, you probably come across all types of students in different places, locations. Have you had the chance to interact with any students in juvenile justice centers or students that are incarcerated or in prison?
Yeah, I've been to, that's a huge part of my life as a writer, is to make time to go and see our young folks who are on the other side of the wall. I've been fortunate to do that also on a global level, right? So I've been to youth prisons all through the South and the East Coast, of course, and all over the West Coast. I mean, the Bay Area alone has, you'd be surprised, the youth prison system in the Bay Area. And I've had an opportunity to go through a lot of those spaces. And you know what's most fascinating about it is it's important to note that America is the only country that I know of that has maximum security youth facilities. I've been to youth prisons in Scotland, and they're more like schools. I've been to youth prisons in Germany, and they feel almost more like monasteries. It's interesting.
Wow.
I've been to youth prisons in London, and they were in there making podcasts.
Hmm.
Right? Gordon Ramsay had a cooking program for them.
Wow.
But when I go to youth prisons in America, they feel like prisons. But what's interesting, and this is also the only country where you can get max time, right? So here, you can be a 15-year-old and you can go to jail forever, right? That's an American thing. And so I've been in these spaces, and no matter what these young people have done, which, by the way, has more to do with sort of what we've done, when they walk in the room with their hands behind their backs and their blues or their browns or their greens on, and you look in their faces, what you will see is a child.
Mm.
It doesn't matter how tough they posture themselves to be. It doesn't matter how they sort of like gas themselves up for the. It doesn't matter whatever defense mechanism they have to have to survive in this space. When they walk in the room, it's impossible for you to not see a 12-year-old. Mm. Therefore, it should be impossible for you to not treat them as such, right? And in order to do that, one has to make sure that they tell themselves, me as an adult, when I walk in the door, I have to remind myself, or at least sort of, you know, reconfirm that like these are children.
Right.
These are not gangsters. These ain't thugs. These ain't monsters. These ain't animals.
Right.
These are my children, my babies, right? And when they walk in that door, it's impossible to see them as anything other than that. And therefore, we get to connect and relate as that, right? You are a child, someone that I love. You happen to be on this side of the wall, but it doesn't mean that you are any different or any less than or that you should be any less valued. And
right.
I think it's been incredible. They've given me more than I'll ever be able to give them in those spaces. And I encourage everybody, one, to consider them.
Mm-hmm.
These are young people who we forget even exist, right? To consider that there are, thousands and thousands of kids locked up. Figure out ways for you all to get involved with the youth penal system. Go check on them kids. You'd be surprised how rarely people show up.
Mm-hmm.
Their parents could be states away. right? Like, go check in and show those young folks some love too. They too deserve your love and deserve your presence.
Thank you for that. So we're going to move on a little bit, and I'd love to talk about your personal education journey.
Yeah.
Kind of thinking all the way through elementary, middle, high, college. So tell us, were you a straight A student? Were you a good student? Were you always interested in writing? What was your experience like?
We elementary school, so I've never had straight A's, which is funny because I feel like my friends think I had straight A's, but I've never gotten straight A's, not one time. I was a good kid though, and I think people were just kind of like, well, he a solid kid. He probably got, and I'm like, no, I don't. I never ever have I had straight A's ever. Elementary school was a breeze, and then everything kind of got up. You know, things sort of turned upside down after that, in terms of grades and me struggling with certain things in school.
Did something happen? Was there something that was like a marker that was the change?
A lot of things happened. My 10 years old was the year that broke me and the year that invented me.
Okay.
At the age of 10. So at second grade, I skipped, right? So I skipped second grade because elementary school was just like, shout out to my mom, because I was overprepared for elementary school. I get to elementary
school.
Your
mom's a teacher, right?
My mom, her second career, yeah, she worked in education.
Okay.
So like, I'm doing my thing, and at the elementary, they're like, he's too bored, he's gonna fail if we don't move him on because he's too bored, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they moved me forward in third grade. My birthday's in December. This puts me 2 years back, right?
Okay.
So in the 10th grade, it's time for me to go to middle school.
Okay.
But unfortunately, what also happens is my grandmother dies. So it's interesting, right? This is when I first started to read the rap. I don't know if anybody's heard my story about reading rap lyrics. I was a kid who had an older brother. I did not like to read because reading was whack back then, right? It was like, you know, like it is what it is. Anyone who was raised in the 80s and 90s, especially if you were a black person, there wasn't a whole lot for us, especially
right.
in contemporary literature. It's a weird
right.
hole in the market right there. There's no archive of my childhood. Right, it doesn't exist, right? And so because of that, I didn't like to read, and because we just, me and my friends, just that's not what we were into.
Right.
Grandma dies, older brother has rap tapes, I start reading rap lyrics. This sort of introduces me to poetry. So when grandma dies, I know what to do.
Mm.
Right?
Express yourself.
At the time, I wasn't self-aware enough in that particular moment. But what I did understand was that I didn't like the way it made me feel to know my mother was feeling bad.
Oh.
And it's the first time that I was hearing my mother broken.
Okay.
And for all of us, I mean, we're all adults. You remember that first time. To hear your mama cry the first time, it's
right.
like a weird, like... I'm sure everybody in here remembers the first time you hear your mother cry. It's like a strange chemical thing happening, right? And so my mom is going through this grief of losing her mother. I'm just trying to figure out how to console her. So I do the thing that I had been studying all this time with these rap lyrics, and I write down a few lines. This sort of is read at the funeral. My family comes up to me and says, we like the way this poem, which I wasn't calling it that at the time, made us feel.
Right.
And now I know that words have power. Shortly after this moment, my parents divorced. Same year. I'm 10 years old.
Okay.
My parents split. They were going through the divorce when my grandmother died. And when my father leaves, so now I'm dealing with like that weird moment of like,
right.
your family's shifting. I'm trying to understand it all. I don't quite understand it all, but I know my father's gone, so he must be the bad guy, right? So I put my energy, you know, toward that. And then because he's gone, my mother is like, we got to figure out what to do with Jay when it comes to middle school. And the environment that I grew up in, the public and local middle school was a little dicey at the time. I would say the school, it don't exist no more. Is anybody from Oxon Hill or knows that area? So Shugart Middle School was the middle school. For those of y'all who are from a different generation, y'all know the school I'm talking about. It was a wild time, right? And my mother was like, your brother went there and we saw what happened to him. We ain't doing it, right?
Right.
So she was trying to figure out, and back then zoning and all that, it was all this stuff.
Yeah.
And so she put me in private school. This is terrible.
Yeah.
Right? Because I was a public school kid, and you're
right.
like, now I got to wear uniforms. I'm going through all of that, right? And I get to this private school, and I'm 2 years younger than everybody, And so, like, I'm dealing with all of these things. I'm away from my friends. I'm away from my neighborhood. I don't understand what's going on. Why we got to go to church and school? Like, I'm dealing with, like, all of this, like, weird stuff that I'm trying to, like, I'm like, this is too much for me. Yeah. And also, my parents aren't together no more. And so I started doing poorly in school.
So 10 was a really pivotal.
Everything changed.
Change for you.
Everything okay. changed. Because I now have all this power because I figured out a way to express myself. But I don't feel like I have any power because everything that I've known has now been upended.
That's powerful. So you learned that you had power through the expression of words.
Oh, yeah.
But yet you still felt like you were powerless in the circumstances and things that were happening to you in your life.
For sure.
Okay.
For sure.
Right. So tell me a little bit then about, so you start to do poorly in middle school, mm-hmm. but you're staying with it, you're going through school. Mm-hmm. You ended up going on to college.
I did. Yeah. I went on to college. High school, I didn't go from middle school to college, though, I should tell you. High school was in there.
Okay.
In high school, there were two teachers I met in high school that changed. And because these are teachers, I feel like this is important. There was a teacher I had in the 10th grade, Miss Blaufus, who's still good friends with me today. And she taught English. And she was the first teacher to recognize that I could do it, that I could do something with it, right? That, like, the language thing was my jam. The words were, like, I love language, but I was just doing my thing. And Ms. Blaufus was the one to be like, this kid is something else happening here. The wild part about it, though, was that I wasn't doing well in her class. So it's not like she was giving me A's and saying, like, you're killing it, kid.
Right.
She was giving me C's.
But she could see your potential, and she could see that your talent, and she still wanted to cultivate that.
Exactly. So she was giving me C's and being like, look, you don't know how to follow directions. Right?
What does that say, though? There's something there, though, right? There's something there about the rules of our schooling practices and not being able to demonstrate what is excellent in the classroom because of the rules, but teachers being able to see something in you and not necessarily being able to cultivate that in a way that translates to good grades.
Exactly.
That's a problem.
I would say so,
yes.
too. I mean, my fear, and I'm grateful that I was kind of a bullheaded kid with a bunch of sort of with more than one affirmative space, right? So if school wasn't an affirmative space, I had my homeboys in the neighborhood who always were like, nah, Jay, don't matter. We love you. You got it. You got it, right?
Okay.
So, but I often think about, and even what I see with the young people today, it does concern me that so often young people believe that their grades are attached to their identities.
Right.
And
so it's
a lot of pressure. Yeah. And it does weird. It can do some damage. I think people really believe that if you get a C that you're an average person, right? Or if you fail,
right,
that you are a failure.
Right.
And that's not the case. And I think for Ms. Blaufus, it was like, nah, I'm going to give you a C based on a rubric because you're not following directions. It's a rubric. It has nothing to do with, like, your identity. It may say something about your personality because you won't follow directions, right? But I can still acknowledge the fact that you have an ability,
right?
And I can pour into your ability while also holding you accountable to the task at hand.
Right.
Two things can be, you know, simultaneously true,
yes.
And that's sort of what it was for me. And then came college.
Okay, I've also heard you talk about Mr. Williams.
Oh,
I believe
Mr.
it is.
Williams. Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about him.
The strangest teacher I ever had, and the teacher who I knew more than any other teacher loved me and loved all of us. He loved us. He loved us, and he made it clear more than anyone had ever made clear. And he taught a class called Global Studies, which is a class he made up and was like, oh, yeah, this is, yeah, I want to teach them about the world. I want to teach them. You know, and I look back on it now, and really what it was a class on how to be a person. Right, he was trying to teach us how to be humans. Right, this is how you sort of exist as a person in the world. Right, and so like the first day of class, he writes on the board. You know, first day is like all these countries. He's like, these are all the places I've been. And we like, want to teach us how to be? You've been all over the world. Right? And this is because we're 17, right? And, you know, and so he's like, and he writes on the board. The first day of class, he writes on the board, ethnocentricity. Right. And we're like, do you know what this means? No, we don't know what it means, right? And he gives us a definition of what it means to be ethnocentric and how dangerous it is, right? How dangerous it is to be ethnocentric, because the world is so big and full of so many ethnicities. And if you are ethnocentric, you believe that everybody else should be just like you, right? That your way is the way, that you are the standard, right? But the world doesn't work that way. You introduce us to delicacies that we'd never try. You know, oh, guys, we're going to grill up some crickets in the classroom today, and we're going to eat these crickets. And okay. We're all like, I don't know if I could do it, right? Like, right. And he's like, well, in other places in the world, these are delicacies, right? And this, that, and the third. And we're having just an experience. In these four walls, we're learning that the world is bigger than our neighborhoods, bigger than the block, bigger than the bus stop, bigger than our homeboy's house, bigger than grandma's table, right? That's what he taught us. And there's that famous story of the fish.
Yes.
Has anyone heard this story? I feel like, because I've told it so many times that I'm a little subconscious. Like, I don't want to keep telling this story. You know what I'm saying?
It's a like, good story, though, and I have a follow-up question to
you. All right, I'll tell a quick version of it.
All right.
So Mr. Williams brings a fish to class. He tells us that he's like, look, you can feed the fish every day, but whatever you do, just don't play around and touch the fish, right? Don't dig your hands in the tank and play around with the fish. Don't lift the fish out of the tank. You know, we're teenagers, right? So he's being preemptive and being like, stop, don't do the thing, right?
Right.
He's like, and if you do touch the fish, then I'm going to have to suspend you, and that's just what it is. This is a no-nonsense rule. Cool. A couple weeks go by, and we feed the fish every day, and this one day we come to class, he takes the fish out of the tank, and he puts it on the floor. And the fish is flopping around, and we all gather around, and we're watching the fish gasp. And finally, two young ladies come over, and they pick the fish up, and they throw it in the tank, and he suspends them, basically, is the story. Because the rules are the rules, right? He said, don't touch the fish by any means. They touch the fish by saving it. And as they were walking down the hall, he says to them, but hold your heads up, because you did the right thing. But sometimes doing the right thing has consequences. And the rest of us had to kind of sit with our cowardice, myself included, had to sit and reckon with my cowardice and then make a decision from that day forward that I would always save the fish, right? Like every day I wake up knowing that today might be the day that I have to save the fish. Are you prepared for that, right? And that is the way that I sort of step out into the world daily, especially dealing with our young people. So that's the story about the fish.
So what would you say now is the fish that you're saving?
I think there are many. I think there are multiple fish. I think, you know, it's interesting, right? Because I think that people would probably assume that the fish I'm saving is the fish that sort of is sort of caught up in the mucky swamp of racism. And yeah, I'd be trying to save them fish too, right? That's up there. But for me, honestly, if I were being honest with you all, I think the fish that I personally am always thinking about is the fish that has to do with sex and gender. I think for me, I'm always considering and thinking about what does it mean to identify and to live in the body of a man. What does it mean when my body is in a space? I work in an industry that is predominantly women. So it's important that I'm always thinking about, like, when I walk in the room, am I adding to the space? Or am I making it uncomfortable? And if I'm making it uncomfortable, what am I doing that might make that might sort of create an environment where other people, specifically people who identify as women, don't feel comfortable with saying whatever it is they want to say? Do I need to always be speaking? Or are there moments where I should probably sit one out? Have I really thought through my own misogyny, my own sort of like male identity in a space where like it's never actually, I mean, growing up, it's never actually checked. And so you become an adult and you don't even know that there are things to unlearn until you've been harmful, right? And in order for me to not be harmful, I have to accept the fact that somewhere in there's probably some nastiness that I got to sort out. And I'd rather be honest about that in hopes to be less harmful than to act like I'm on some valiant pedestal where I am a good guy, not understanding that I'm leaving a wake of harm behind me. Right? And these are the things that if I'm thinking about the fish I'm saving, it's probably that one more often than not. Am I fighting on behalf or thinking and speaking on behalf of what it is for me to be a black person in America? Of course. And do I want equity? Do I want voice and to be seen as a human being, and for my young people who come from my environment, black folks, brown folks, to be seen as, of course. Simultaneously,
right,
I want to make sure that while we're fighting for on behalf of black and brown kids, that the black and brown kids who happen to be boys understand that there's more work to be done to ensure that their homegirls are safe in the world after we've created a safe space from what we deem to be an opposing force, which is racism, that they also got to be safe from you. Are you willing to do the extra work to make sure they're safe from you, right? Yeah. And that's extra, and that's tough, and it's icky, and it feels uncomfortable. It's hard to say it out loud, right? But it is what it is.
It's real, though.
It's a real thing.
And I like that you're saving that fish.
That's the one. And I got to hold my friends accountable.
Yes.
Are you willing to look your homeboys in the face and be like, oh, we don't talk like that? Yo, we don't do that. I can't, like, right. That. And I, every day, that's the thing that I'm thinking about, probably, honestly, more than anything these days.
Right. Well, thank you. Thank you for sharing that. I just want to let the audience know that we're going to get to audience questions in just a short period of time. There are two mics here in the auditorium where you could ask your questions from. And then also for those of you online, if you submit a question, we'll make sure to bring your voice into the room. So let's move to your work, your craft.
You gonna ask me craft questions?
I'm gonna ask you craft questions.
I hope so, by the way, because don't nobody ask me craft questions.
Okay, all
so
right.
This, I'm so excited.
Yes.
Everybody just be like, what's it like being black in this industry?
It's hard.
Exactly. End of statement, right?
Right. So we had a little montage going before the talk, and I was noticing that you're kind of producing a lot of books every year. and I think that I'm right that one of your first self-publications was with the Smithsonian. Is that right?
Close. We used the printer that used to print for the Smithsonian.
Sonia.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Hey, that was not nice. Expensive.
Oh. Well, we are the nation's museum, so we have to pay for it somehow. So I really would love to know more about your craft, because that's a high production, but your intimacy in your books is so authentic. Mm. I think that what you have been able to do through your work is tap into a lot of different emotions that resonate for many, many people. If it's talking about grief or the cycles of grief, if it's talking about loss, murder, mm-hmm. I think that the authenticity that you bring to each of your characters is not generic. And so I'm just wondering, like, how is it that you approach your work and are able to produce at such a large volume at a sustained rate?
At a sustained rate, yeah. I don't know.
Okay.
You know, I think some of it comes from fear. You know, I have a weird obsession. I'm a bit obsessive. And some of that obsession is just my personality type. Like, that's just how I'm wired. If I'm in it, I'm in it. I'm one of those people that ain't no, right? It's zero or it's 100. Like, I'm one of those people. But the other part of that is just fear, right? I got
What's
it again.
The fear?
The fear is, and I don't have it as much anymore, I just can't turn it off, right?
Okay.
But the fear at the beginning of all of this was that that the door would be closed. Mm-hmm. It's a rare feeling to know that you're like 10 steps from your dream.
Right.
It's right there, you can see it.
Right.
Right, and you know that all you have to, and it's rooted in sort of the way I was raised. You know, I come from a Southern woman who was one of those sort of moms, black mom, very black. And black people in the room know exactly what
that is.
Very, very
yes.
black.
Yes, you had some home training.
Exactly. Yes. And part of that is this idea, and this is, it comes from a good place, but it can be damaging.
Right.
Right, because it comes from her fear.
Right.
For obvious reasons, right? But part of that was like, you got to work twice as hard
But you have to work twice as hard to accomplish what you want to accomplish.
Well, you know, the saying is, and I did the math on this, and I really stuck to this. The saying is what? It's twice as hard for half as much, right? So the math on that means you got to work three times as hard to break even, four times as hard to get ahead.
Oh,
that's the math on it. We won't do the math.
Do you feel like you're working four times as hard?
That's what you've seen.
Yeah.
Right? That's what it is.
Yeah.
Right? Four times as hard than all my colleagues.
That's what it is.
That's what it is, right? Okay. And so what happens when I show up to places or I'm in a bookstore, I'm at a signing, is that people come and they say, like, yo, you've been able to produce this, and there's this weird awe. And what I always want to say that I don't say, but what I always want to say is what you are in awe of is awful.
Oh.
And is doing awful things to me, right? To my body, to my mind, right? Like, for me to be able to emotionally, to write anything, for any of you who've ever done it, is, you know that this is like an emotional toll.
Right.
Right. This is like I sit alone with my own thoughts every day for hours. And every single voice in my body and in my head and in my psyche and in my spirit comes rushing forth every day. The ones that are afraid, the ones that are traumatized, the ones that are arrogant, the ones that are funny and goofy, the ones that are irresponsible and immature, the ones that are courageous, right? All of them are there talking at the same time. And I somehow have to figure out how to push the ones back that I don't need and pull the ones forth that I do need to make a thing for everybody else to tell me
how good it is.
Hey, man, you really did that thing. And I'm like, yo, I'm dying.
Right.
Like, I'm going through, right? And that's really what it is. So I think it's fear. And now it's just a part of my life. Like, I don't know how to stop the ball from rolling. And this is not a good thing. I am, just now, I'm talking to him, my buddy is here, and I always talk to him about this. Like, I'm trying to figure out, like, we've been having conversations about, like, bro, I'm trying to play. I got to figure out how to play a sport again. I got to figure, I'm back in the gym. I need to figure out how to, because I got to find ways to divert it. If not, like, this thing, this is enough to sort of push you over the edge. And so I'm grateful to have produced what I've produced, but it comes at a tremendous cost. That is never your business, but it is a true thing.
Right.
Right? It's an honest thing. It ain't normal.
Right.
Ain't nobody supposed to work like this.
That's why I ask, because I know that you're also doing podcasts, you're doing appearances, you're doing writing. And so I love how you kind of wrap that into, I'm going to just paraphrase.
Yeah, please.
The importance of balance and recognizing taking care of your mental health.
Yes.
And I appreciate how you are saying that you're working towards that balance. And
every day. Shout out to my therapist, man, being there.
Yeah. And I actually really love the way that you bring that into your conversations, because mental health is something that we don't talk about in our communities very much at all, but let alone in the Black community, it's very, you know, taboo.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, it none of this matters enough to me, right? I love our kids. Really do. And anybody who knows me knows that this work is coming from a place of sheer passion for our children, right? I don't have to do this no more. I do it because I love, I really have a heart and a passion for it, right? But at the end of the day, I can't self-destruct, because then I have nothing to give them.
Right?
And so I'm trying to figure out, and we know the story. We've seen how this goes. It ain't like I'm the only one or the first person to go through it, right? And so because I know that, and because I come from a family that's very open about that, and because I know what my illnesses are, you try to be as preemptive as you can, and you're just trying to, like, there's no stigma for me. It's like, this is what it is, right? And I have therapy every Monday. I have friends who stay on top of me. I have routines that I do. If it's time to take a nap, I take a nap, and I don't feel bad about it. I tell people no when I got to tell them no, right? Like, whatever it is, so that I can continue to do the work that I know that I'm here to do.
And
that
goes
for all of us, by the way.
Yeah, if you need a break, we have 21 museums.
Right. Like, I'll be down here.
A national zoo. Yeah.
All of that.
Astrophysical center.
Everything.
So anytime you need a private tour, just let me know.
All right. You're going to be mad when you get that call.
Okay. We're going to go ahead and open it up for questions. I do want to just also make sure that we talk about one thing in particular. You know, you talk about how your writing is particularly that you're passionate in doing it for young Black people.
Yes.
Young Black men.
Yes.
I don't like young Black men term, so let me, young Black male youth.
Yes.
I don't like putting the label of men.
Yeah, they ain't
on,
men.
Right. So,
they boys.
Yeah. Yeah.
They boys.
So tell me your intentionality behind that.
I think Well, first, I think it just comes from a place of, like, that's what I know, because I was a young black boy. I still consider myself young. I'm not, but I, you know, in here, I'm like, you know. And also because I think the truth is I was fortunate enough to grow up around a bunch of young black boys. And the boys that I grew up around, these friends, these brothers of mine, they gave me an opportunity to be a whole black boy. A free black boy, in the midst of an environment that could have easily gone any other way. But they never, if I felt sensitive about something and I felt like I needed to cry, I could stand in front of my friends and just go ahead and rock out, right? And nobody would, there was never a moment where they were like, you know, tighten up or toughen up. It was kind of like, yo, take care of it, get it out, brother, it's cool. Mm-hmm. And this is when we were like 12, 10, 11, right? Like it was never, wow. I never felt the need to be somebody else. I mean, when I started writing poetry as a 10-year-old, you know what it is to tell your homeboys in the neighborhood, like, yo, this is what I'm doing, right? And they're like, all right, well, if that's what you're doing, then we with it, right? I started going to open mics, and, you know, I go to open mics as a 15-year-old, and my friends who ain't want nothing to do with this are like, all right, bro, we all coming to the open mic, and we going to just... Everybody better clap for you too, right? We going like, right? Like that's sort of the way it was. And so because of that, I try to make sure that I take the opportunity to write young men as whole, because they don't get to see themselves as whole. And they don't all, and it's not always safe to feel whole in their environments. It's not always safe to exercise humility or vulnerability in their environment. So I try to put it in a book so they can share those secrets in the pages.
I love
that's
it.
That's all.
I love it. Thank you. I see Dr. Knox has a question for you.
I do, Dr. Chism. Thank you. I'm a big
fan.
I'm
a doctor, too. Stop referring to me as Dr. Reynolds, man.
Okay, doc. Okay, I loved your question on craft, Dr. Chism, and I wanted to ask you this. It seems like there's a new dialogic between writers like you and KSA Lehman, who are kind of rewriting black masculinity or introducing concepts like what you just said, that your actual reality was that you were writing poetry, you were speaking to your friends, you were crying, and they were supportive, and that is actually the expression of your experience.
Yeah.
And I think that in your writing, you're creating this space for interiority as lived that creates maybe a space for these young people that you're visiting in different places to explore that for themselves. Mm-hmm. My question for you is, what do you see metabolizing from that in those various spaces? And if something is stopping things from happening, or if something is still in the way, what is that unspoken thing that you notice maybe stops the magic of what was happening in your global studies class, where there was that moment of resonance that I can be both a harmed person in the world and someone who's harmful because of my cowardice, and breaking down that binary of self and other and harmful and harmed and all the other, the multiplicity of themes that you're exploring, and making all of that what it means to be a human being.
It's tough. I mean, That's a lot, you know. I think, how is it metabolizing? You shout out to my brother Kiese, you know, because he, somebody that I love dearly, and we talk about these things, he and I. And I think, you know, I just think, honestly, I honestly think, number one, I think what gets in the way sometimes is exposure, like everything else, right? So like you say, like, well, how come a young man doesn't know how to do that? Well, because a young man has never seen those things, or because a young person's never seen that, right? So sometimes I think it's about exposure and understanding that we're playing a long game. So I'm not expecting every kid to all of a sudden be like, you know what, dog, I do feel like I gotta cry, right? I'm ready, right? Like I think at the end of the day, like this is the long game, and this is conversation, and like these kids, they have. Who that kid might be at 21 could be completely different because of the moment that we had when that kid was 10. But it may not look like that until he's 21, right? And I'm okay with that. My job is to pour into them and be faithful to the process. And one thing that I always do that I think is fascinating, and I've seen this happen so many times, right? Before I leave, especially when I'm talking to young boys, I'm like, yo, I love y'all. Mm. And you just watch and you see, or I'll single one out, yo, I love you. Mm. I love you. And you'll watch them squirm a little bit. And I just keep saying it.
It might be the first time that they heard
that's
somebody
what I'm saying.
Say,
exactly.
I love you. Yeah.
And I'll just keep saying it until he stops squirming.
Yeah.
Right? Because once he stops squirming, he won't squirm again. That's it.
Right.
Right, let this settle in. This me telling you I love you doesn't have to be an uncomfortable thing, brother.
Right.
I love you. And I don't have to add any extra to it. Right? I can just say I love you, period. I love you. And eventually you'll see him settle down. He does not owe it to me to say it back. I just want him to get comfortable with hearing it, right?
Yeah.
Another time I had a young kid who was acting up in a crowd, right? These are my favorite young people, by the way. Right? They are because they possess something that we muzzle. Because they're being what we call disruptive.
Mm-hmm.
But boy, I wouldn't want to live in a world where young people aren't disruptive.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I'm like, oh, okay. So he's talking and talking, and I'm trying to talk to the rest of the kids, and he over here cutting up. So I'm like, yo, you think you could do what I'm doing better than me, right? Mm-hmm. And he's like, yeah. Now, this is when, in this moment, I'm realizing, dang, he called my bluff, right? Right? So I'm like, he's like, yeah. I'm like, cool, come up to the stage, because I can't back out now. I'm in it, right? Come up to the stage. He comes up to the stage, and I'm thinking, like, all right, well, here goes the microphone. I'm waiting for him to pull out. He takes the microphone, right?
Wow.
And I'm like, all right, well, now we're jumping into the deep end. And the teachers are, of course, like, everybody's like, I'm like, no, it's cool, it's cool, it's cool. And I like, go ahead, do your thing. And I like nudge him out to the front of the stage. And he grabs the mic, and he says, yo. And when he says yo, he hears his voice.
Mm.
Loud. He hears it bouncing off the walls in the theater. And he turns around and looks at me, and his eyes are this big. And I'm like, go ahead. And he says, yo, again. And then he turns around and he gives me the microphone. And I said, you good? And he said, yeah. And I said, you want to sit up here? And he's like, yeah. And he has a seat on the edge of the stage. Now, what happens in that moment is this is the first time he's ever heard himself bigger. It's the first time he's ever imagined himself bigger than who he is. Heard his voice loud enough for everyone. Think about what that means for this kid, right? These are the things I'm thinking about, right? So it may not always come in the form of a hug. It may not always come in the form of I love you. But at the end of the day, it's just an opportunity to pour into our young men to say, like, I can see you. I can really see you,
right?
And I'm willing to listen when you're ready to talk, right? And if you want to cry and you want it to be private, come holler at me and I'll tuck you away. Right, all of that, right? Like, these are small things, and what that looks like at 17, at 18, at 21, at 25, in fatherhood is a man that comes in the room and kisses his son. That's what that looks like. And you know what that looks like? That looks like a kid that grows up and realizes that there's never anything bad with a man kissing a man, so I ain't gotta be homophobic.
Right.
Right? This is how it metastasizes,
yes.
Right? Like, that's what can happen.
Yeah.
Small things.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful.
Thank you.
I know that we have a question coming in from our streaming audience. Yay.
Thanks for your genius and capacity to empower young people to be their very best, most authentic selves. That's one of many comments that are very important.
That's what's up. Thank you.
Beautiful.
A question, though. Catherine Gallo asks, who do you find are the best sources of support for feedback when you're developing your stories?
Oh, nobody see my stories. I don't do that. Now, I know I got a lot of friends who have writing circles, and I'm way too insecure to share my work before it's done. And that's honest. Like, nobody sees my work. No one. No loved one, no friend. Nobody sees my work until it's done. I turn it into, and usually my agent don't even see the work. I usually turn it into my editor, and then she and I, because she's really the only person I really trust, because she's been working with me for so long, and we had that relationship. And so it's usually just my editor and I who sort it out. But don't nobody. So for all the insecure writers out there, it's okay.
It's okay.
It's okay.
Okay. We're running out of time, and I know that we have people lining up. So I just
we can't take an extra 5 minutes.
We can definitely take an extra 5 minutes.
You had that. And this would you got the microphone. This would you just like, come on, we can do extra 5 minutes. We can
ride. Okay. Let's make sure we get to everybody who's at the mic.
Yeah.
So, Adriana,
it's
go
all
ahead.
Good.
Hi, I'm Adriana Wild. I'm a student journalist at Ohio University, and so I totally get your being scared of failure thing.
Yeah.
I do political journalism, and the 24-hour news cycle is brutal. I was just wondering, have you failed on what, and what was it like, and how did you move forward?
I have Kleenex.
It's such a good question. And you know, there's that part of me that wants to answer the question. You know, people that say, like, no, there's no such thing as failure. Sure, there is. Right? Don't you hate those people that are like, oh no, I don't have any regrets? Of course you do, right? Anyway, it's so weird, right? So here's the thing. I will, when I can look over it all, I think there are a few things, but the one that sticks out the most, my first deal, I was 21 years old when I first signed my first deal. And here's the thing, at the time, I thought that in and of itself was a success, right? And it was to some extent. And then that book came out, right? And I know we all like to pretend that we just make the thing for ourselves. You hear writers, you know, in the midst of our like weird self-righteous high horses say, like, I make art for me. And it's like, so you don't care if nobody buy it, huh? You don't care? Because I can tell you that when nobody bought it, I was not like, it's okay because you made it for yourself. That's not what I was thinking, right? What I was thinking was, I have failed, right? And when I say nobody, I mean nobody. Right, and I remember after that trying to go to grad school because I was like, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I thought I was gonna be a famous writer. I was 23 at this point. And I was like, I thought I was gonna be, you know, in my mind, writers were rich and famous. I don't know what I didn't grow up reading, right? I know nothing. So I thought I was gonna be a famous writer, and now I realize that I don't know what I'm getting ready to do with my life. Maybe I'll try to go to grad school, but I wasn't a good student in undergrad, so I could never get into grad school. Right, it was rejected 3 times with a book in the store. Rejected 3 times, and then I took a job in a clothing store, and sort of that's what I did for a very long time. I sold clothes in New York City. The clothing store didn't make me feel like a failure, but everything leading up to it made me feel like I'd failed, to the point that I even was considering letting it all go and being like, hey, you know, one book in the store is more than most. Right? And that was sort of the plan. How did I get through it? My friends. I've been saying this a lot lately because I think it's important. Friendship, to me, might be the most important relationship. I don't know what life is without friendship. Because it was my friends who encouraged me. It was my friends who helped to pay my rent, right?
Good friends.
Because they had chosen
to help to nurture the stream.
Yeah, and after college, they all got jobs, and I didn't. Right? I was like, I'm about to be an artist. Right? They were like, we're gonna go ahead and go to work. Right? And so they had money, right? And they would take care of me. But most importantly, there was one friend who was a mentor to me at the time, and this mentorship is so important. Please, 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 because younger people sometimes have a hard time with mentorship these days because mentorship is supposed to be rigorous. And this is the part that I want to impart this upon you, right? Mentorship is supposed to be rigorous. Everybody's scared to be somebody flunky. Don't be. I promise you. You're going to have to, because in the midst of you sort of somebody who is trying to sort of mentor you, in the midst of them telling you that you got to do this and you need to do this and do this for me and this and the third, they also giving you a whole lot of game and they walking you into spaces you can't get into without them. And they'll be there for you in these moments, right? Because my mentor, because I believe in the old school way of mentorship where it's like whatever they say, to this day, Jackie Woodson can walk in here right now and be like, hey, Jay, you got to get off the stage, you got to go to lunch. And I'm going to be like, hey, it's a wrap for this. Because that's the way I believe in that, right? The old school way of like apprenticeship, right? And one of my mentors came in the clothing store. His name is Christopher Myers. His father was Walter Dean Myers. He comes in the clothing store, and he is the one who says, you should write one more story. And you should give it everything you got, and you should break all the rules and just do it. Be honest with the page, right? Do your thing. And because I respected him, because I was tapped out, because I respected him, I gave it another shot. And it changed my life.
Which book was that?
That was When I Was the Greatest.
Okay.
It changed my life. So my advice to you is, yes, failure comes, right? It is what it is. If you don't take no lumps, you won't know how to manage life when you start winning, right? But on the flip side of that, you got to have support around you, right? One person, to be able to really be like, hey, cry for a moment, get yourself together, and let's move forward. Somebody you respect, right? That would be my advice.
Nice.
All right, we got a few more questions. We're gonna keep, don't worry about it.
We're good. Let's go to this side first.
Good luck with your journalism. It's rough out here. Sheesh.
She's at a good school, my alma
mater. Where you at?
Ohio University.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, thank you for your whole talk and everything that you do, and I have so many questions to ask you, but one thing that really stuck with me when you started to speak was about how you are so intentional about how you love all of these kids. Mm-hmm. What happened in your life, or how did you become so intentional about that? I think a lot of us as educators, we too feel that same way, but perhaps we're not as intentional about it. Maybe we don't say it like that, or we don't show it the way that you do. What brought you to this, to be so intentional about it?
I don't know. Nobody's ever asked this. Nobody's ever asked this question. And I'm sitting here thinking, in a very sort of quick moment of recollection, and this may change tomorrow when I think about it more, but I think it has to do with my mom. I grew up in the neighborhood house. You know how every neighborhood got the neighborhood house, mm-hmm. You know what
right.
I mean?
Mm-hmm.
The neighborhood mom, the person that everybody knows, like, you can just go over there, she's going to have some food for you. Mm-hmm. If you got to go to an event and you ain't got no clothes, she got some extra clothes for you. She got, right, like, this person that, like the matriarch of the neighborhood, right? And my mom was that person. And I think what she did, though, and my day one, my ace is in the room, and he can attest to this, what she did for us as young people, right? I'm talking like, I mean, people 4, 5, 6 on up through, you know, we were always there in my mother's house. And this is 8, 9 people at a time. And in those teenage years, what she did for us was she gave us a space to really, like, really say everything without judgment. Mm. So instead of her being like, y'all shouldn't be talking like that, she would be like, well, then let's talk about it. Since y'all think y'all know, let's get to it, right? Let's get into the complicated conversations around sex. Let's talk about it, right? And really creating a safe space for that, right? Let's get into, like, whatever. She was never afraid to lean into the muck, right? She wasn't afraid to get some on her. And I think because of that, she was able to watch a group of kids become who we all became. And I think, and a lot of my friends are like, yo, thank you. I went to go see your mother today. I went to go check on your mother. I'm going to call your mother. Wow. I went, right? Because my mother was the one, this was the one house you could come to where you weren't going to be chastised for being a teenager. You weren't going to be judged for being adolescent. She wasn't going to be squeamish about whatever you had to say. If you want to talk about it, she was there to be like, all right. She was going to sit at the table with you and be like, let's really get to it. And let's talk about it in a way that's going to be safe and comfortable for you. We're going to laugh a little bit. And because I'm an older lady, I'm also going to put you on some games so that you know how to move in the world and so that you ain't out here doing things that have put you in a jam, right? And I think that's where it comes from, because that's normal for me. That was normal in my house. I don't have no stories of discomfort with my mother.
Right.
Zero. Mm. And because of that, it ain't nothing for me to stand up here and tell y'all who I am or to write a book or to write books about these shorties, about who they actually are, right. Not who we sort of project or perceive them to be, but who they are when you turn your back. You know, and I think that's what it is.
Beautiful. Well, I'm thankful for your mother.
Hey, shout out to the old lady. I love her very much. Isabel Reynolds is her name. Make sure you say your parents' names or whoever you love. You know, get their names on wax, on document.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Kayla. I just wanted to know if you've come across students that are apathetic towards reading and learning in general. And if so, what advice can you offer to educators that are experiencing sort of heightened apathy sort of as we go through the pandemic?
Yeah, it's rough. It's rough. First, I just want to say for all educators who are dealing with it, you know, hold your heads, you know what I mean? Like, and be gentle with yourselves. Because at the end of the day, nobody was trained for this, right? Like, this isn't what we are. This wasn't a class you took. You know what I mean? So first and foremost, there's that. But the other thing is to also extend a little grace to the shorty, right? Like, this new for them too. Right? It's a lot going on out here, and apathy is real. What I always do, I say that to say, first and foremost, I'm not a teacher, so I'm very respectful of the fact that I don't have the answer here because I'm not in that classroom and I don't know, right? But I do know, for me, when I meet a young person who's like, I don't like to read, I always tell them, yeah, I didn't mean either when I was that, because that's true, right? Or, yo, I don't like to write. Guess what? You think you're bad at writing? Huh, your teacher's bad at writing too. She just don't want to tell you. But she's terrible at it. I always tell my friends, like, yo, y'all be assigning 5-paragraph essays. When the last time you wrote one? And they're like, yo, I don't know if I could. Exactly, right? So I think that there's this weird sort of, like, there's an intimacy breakdown. So, like, the apathy gets to persist because the empathy is broken down. Right? And so I often wonder, If we can figure out ways to create empathy and intimacy in the midst of that empathy, if the apathy becomes something that's a bit more brittle, if we can kind of chip away at it, right? So I always tell youngers, like, yo, I didn't like reading when I was your age either. Why you ain't like reading? Because the books were boring. The books boring to you too, right? Yeah, books be mad boring, yo. Cool. I'd be like, look, let me give you a pitch then. I pitch kids all the time. I'm like, what would you do? That's it, all the time. I'm like, yo, would you watch a TV show if the TV show was about a dude who was trying to figure out, like, what to do about the fact that his mother married the man that killed his father? Kids are always like, yo, that's wow, right? And then I'm like, yo, that's Hamlet. Right? Like, what would you do if I told you a story about a kid whose brother get murdered in the street and he got to figure out if he's going to avenge his brother's death, but he only got 60 seconds to decide? What would you do? I don't know. That's crazy. Cool. Well, I got a book for that. Hey, it's a book you can read in an hour. It's only 20 words on a page. It's called Long Way Down, right? Like, yeah. There are ways for us to do it, but I feel like we got to lean into the entertainment of reading.
Right.
But we be leaning into the academia, right? And I'm like, don't nobody really care about it, right? Kids want to know, how you going to entertain me? I don't know why we don't lean that way by any means, right? Yeah. It's language arts, but we only teach language. We don't teach art.
Ooh.
Let's lean into the art part.
I love it.
Which is the entertainment element.
Yes.
And maybe we can get them a little, maybe we can hook them, right?
I love that.
At least some of them.
I love it. And kids, I've been watching the videos. They are so excited about your works.
Of course.
Yes.
I'm talking about boogers and fart jokes.
Right? Okay, we're over time, which
all
is
right.
Fine.
We got
but I want one last small request. So I know that you have this this activity called brain yoga.
Mm.
So tell us a little bit about that, and I'm going to pull up a slide.
Brain yoga was a game that I started during the pandemic. It was something that I used to use, though, all the time. When I teach grad school, I use it for my students in grad school, and I use it for myself as brain exercise, creativity exercises, because everybody in here knows the older you get, the more you have to work to preserve your imagination. So this is my imagination exercise for myself that I ended up using with these kids on Instagram during the pandemic. And then it became a thing, and then I sold out. But it's a whole thing happening with brain yoga. We'll be on the market soon again.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's kind of a stimulating exercise for your brain. And you take two objects, right?
Two mundane, two banal objects.
Okay.
Right? Like a clock and a refrigerator.
Okay.
And you get, like, sometimes I give them 20 seconds on Instagram, but, you know, however much time you want, and you invent something new by combining those two sort of banal household objects.
Okay. Well, let's go to our second exercise. I had two for you, but we're just going to do one.
Okay.
So let's go to the trumpet. And so behind you, you'll see that we have the assigned edition of the of Zora Neale Hurston's book, Their Eyes Are Watching God.
Yeah.
And also from our African American History and Culture Museum. And also the trumpet owned by Louis Armstrong. So
dang.
From American History.
Yeah.
So go.
Do you want me to go?
Yeah.
I mean, all right, let's see. What I would do with these two things is I probably would invent some sort of game for some young person where it would be the equivalent, almost like pickleball, but it would be a one-sided pickleball. It would almost be like if a person had like a ball machine where the balls come out for the batting practice. And what I would do is I would take the Eyes Are Watching God joints, right? I would take the pages, rip the pages out of the book. I know, I get it. But I rip the pages out of the book, and I would ball them up, and I would put them in the trumpet, and then I would blow the sort of balls at the young person, and every one that the young person hit would be like, you know, the game would be like, if you hit everyone, then cool, but if you miss one, you got to open it up, and you got to read that particular one, and we got to do context.
Ooh, I love it. Snap.
Or something.
Nice. Nice.
Hey, well, man. Your ticket's still ticking.
So, will you stick around and sign a couple books for us?
I got you, for sure.
Okay. So, Jason's going to stick around, sign a couple books, so it'll be right out in the lobby. I just want to thank you for what you're giving to the world, nation.
Thank you.
You just want to take the ramp?
This way?
Yeah. So, just really quickly, I just want to say thank you to everyone for joining us. If you would like to have a book signed by Dr. Reynolds, we ask that you please go ahead and line up on the side here on the ramp, and we'll take care of you. If you're not staying to have a book signed, we do have to clear the auditorium because we have another event coming in. So, but thank you for being here with us at the National Education Summit. Thank you.